turn the spots down a little bit? I can't really see anybody here. No.
Down.
Yeah. Or turn the house up a little bit? Maybe? Anyway, is everyone having a good time? Being such great hosts. Anyway, tonight we have a stand-up comedian here all the way from Los Angeles, California. He performs weekly at the Laugh Factory, Hollywood. He's toured with Russell Peters, Dave Chappelle, and Stalin. He did a 7-city tour sponsored by the U.S. State Department. He's even won an award for breakout international comedian in our very own Gucci. He's even been featured on NBC, Nickelodeon, and NPR. You can look him up on funnyindian.com. He made a video that went viral. I am Indian. Please welcome
There are 1.3 billion of us. Cardinals are okay. Not all that Christopher Columbus got lost. Sure, we love our states, but the strength in numbers. One out of every 6 human beings is Indian. So stop dividing. The British already did that once. And we need to quit saying Indian because we are selling to eat that. Our hearts are Indian. We're feelers. We give the world a body of films. And then Ravi Shankar and Zubin Mehta and Lata Mangeshkar and I both the allure of the Kama Sutra.
Me, the amazing audience already. It is an honor to be here at AHN. And thank you so much for joining me tonight during this comedy hour we have. Round of applause if you've been to AHNA before. Everyone applaud if this is your very first one. We got a pretty good mix. That sounds pretty good. Who came from the farthest away? All right. Who's here from New York City? And New York State, just New York in general. All right. Anyone from New York?
Canada.
All right, Canada. We're in Canada. Did you like it all one place? There's no cities in Canada. It's just Canada. That's all there is to it. From Toronto? Toronto? Vancouver? Okay, let's make it. That sounds good. Toronto. Okay, any further than Canada?
California.
California? Okay. That's not farther than Canada, but apparently it's you also. So. There is definitely not far. India? Really? Are you come here from India? You know, you're meeting each other. Okay. You're the INS. Okay, that's nice. Wonderful. Great. I'm glad I brought up everybody. These are just jokes. Everybody relax. It's totally good. We're going to keep it clean mostly. It's like PG clean, so keep it pretty clean. We're going to keep it as Indians like to say vegetarian. Okay? Because at these conventions, I always have uncles and aunties say, okay, keep veg jokes. No non-veg jokes. No, just veg, okay? So that's a big thing because I perform at a lot of weddings, and I performed at a wedding recently, and it was hilarious because I did all clean material. You could tell some of the uncles were a little disappointed. You know? You got it, right? Because they're like, we have to keep it clean for a wedding, but you can do some, you know, come out to our seat, and we'll pay. And you come to some non-vegetables. That's exactly what they did. They were like, well, how much will it cost? And they're already negotiating me. I know they're Indian for sure, right? And so, well, yeah, okay, I don't know. Does everybody give me like $20? I'll come up there. So I go to the suite, and it's all uncles, and they're drinking Johnny White, you know, Johnny Black, rather. Johnny White.
know Johnny White that I know of, but Johnny White. And after the end of the set, after I finished doing all these real dirty jokes that I did not do now, they also like hand me $20 bills. And I'm like, yeah, I'm going to put it in my mail. You know, you guys think like a lot. Okay, you guys are a good audience. I want to see how that went. That's going to go. So, is anyone here asking from the Midwest? Yeah. Whereabouts? Chicago. The capital of the Midwest. All right, very nice. I'm going to Chicago next week. I like how the lights are totally schizophrenic, by the way. Like, we cannot figure out, do we want dark or light, or do we want it, like, Punjabi or Tamil Nadu? Like, how do we want it? Really? So, this is the question. So, if I actually, that's pretty good, I think, for now. Yeah. Okay, can I say TK? Can we speak Hindi? Probably not much. So, no? 40-40? Okay, the other, oh, good. See, then what's good about performing in a South Indian function is I could pretend like I know Hindi. This is great. But you won't know the difference. So, awesome. I can pretend like I'm connected to my heritage, which is awesome. You guys probably guessed I'm originally from Ohio. You probably did not guess that at all. Like, no one guessed that I'm from Ohio. I was born and raised in Ohio. I spent a lot of my life there. And that's why I speak like this. That's why I have this kind of white voice. Because, you know, they would call people like us almonds. Because we're brown on the outside and we're white on the inside. Right? So they call us almonds. It wasn't racist, really. It was really just we got along with the foods, you know? Like, it could be Twinkies or bananas. You know what I mean? People could be Oreos. So we really got along really well. You would like white on the inside, mellow on the outside. Everybody got along really well. But and they call us almonds, which is fine. But I felt like they should call us coconuts. You know, because we're hairy. I think that would make a lot. They should call us coconuts, not almonds. Because Indians are very hairy people. I mean, the men too. And forget you. This tour was called Make Chai Not War, okay? But I gotta say that slowly, Make Chai Not War, because we were on TV in India, and when I say it's fast, Make Chai Not War, I thought I was saying Make China War. That was a little disaster that we don't want to happen in India, we don't want to happen, so gonna be enunciated when I say Make Chai Not War. So, picking up this tour, because this is a while, it's like 3 years ago, and I got back from India a couple months ago. I bring this up is because Senator Rand Paul keeps bringing up this tour in his attack lies against Hillary Clinton. Because the reason for this tour, it was sponsored by the State Department. The government spent $100,000 on sending 3 comedians to India, which I know sounds like the beginning of a joke. But that is exactly what happened. And I thought that Rand Paul would be a fan of it because it's Make China War, he's a member of the Tea Party. But that did not really work out at all, okay? He's still not a big fan at all. So what happened was, I'm Hindu. End of year, right? This is a Hindu. Absolutely. Hindu, four of your arms. Okay, right. It's awesome. Fellow Hindu, myself. So, I'm Hindu. My really good friend, Azhar, is Muslim. And so, he and I wanted to, you know, start something to ease the tension in the world between Muslims and Hindus. And, you know, we saw how well that worked. It really didn't do anything. But we did our part. The 7 billion people of you guys need to work harder, but we did what we could do. And so, Father and I agree on everything except the final mission of our souls. We went on this tour, and he's the biggest Muslim comedian in the world. He's a big brown man with a big black beard. And he kind of looks like Santa Claus, like after he slides down the chimney. Okay? So, Father and I went on this tour, and we go over there. What was crazy is that most of the states were really cool. Kerala, Tamil Nadu, all these states were really cool. They were all great. Maharashtra is where we created problems. Because they said they needed a copy of our script. And we're like, well, we don't have a script, really. We just, you know, we perform, we do our thing. It's not a play or a musical or anything like that. And they're like, well, we need a copy. And we're like, well, we were really busy, you know, because it was December, it was Christmas time, and I'm Hindu and he's Muslim. I have no idea why we were busy actually during Christmas, now that I think about it. We were not celebrating Christmas, but we were busy anyway. Like, and we said, well, what you can do, you can go on YouTube, and you can, like, videos, and you can write down the words from the videos, and there's your set. Honestly, I think they were like, for no, a stamp or a stamp. I think they were Uber drivers who couldn't find a I really don't think they worked the job. You don't have the people. That's total insanity. So we were over there for a couple of weeks. And going to the bathroom in India is definitely an experience. Okay? We'll just say it's an experience. All right? I'm not going to say it's good or bad. It just is what it is. So we went to a Chinese restaurant. I really needed to go to the bathroom. And so I went, you know, to the door of the facilities. Sorry, Canadians, the washroom. Okay, let me put it in terms you'll understand. Okay, which really makes sense actually, because you wash in there. You don't take a bath in there, right? Restroom. I'm not resting. I'm going in. Right. So washroom is accurate actually. So on the door of the bathroom, it read "man," and it was a Chinese restaurant. Of course, Chinese and Indian people love to make fun of each other all the time, right? Right now, I promise. Like Chinese convention and the Chinese Indian about to make fun of Indians. So I'm just going to even it out right now, right? So we're doing this and I go to the bathroom and it says man. And I'm laughing. I'm like, oh, the Chinese in India, they don't know English very well. They put man instead of men. And I open up the door and there's only one toilet. They're Chinese, man. They're all just, they're right. Not men. There's only one toilet. That was so ridiculous. Now, I, all the time I went to the bathroom, I only went twice in 2 weeks, just so you know. So I really didn't. So we were on our way rescue from Calcutta to Durgapur, which is, this is a map of India, by the way. If you knew, like, people from Michigan love to give you the hand. This is the map of India. So if people from Michigan give you that, you can give them this, okay? So we were going from Calcutta to Durgapur, and I had to go to the bathroom. So we pulled over to the road. We saw like a line of stores. And restaurants. Oh, this will be, you know, we'll find a good bathroom here. I don't know what I was thinking about. And we get out and we go in, and I see a door for the bathroom. It just reads gents. Gents. And I get all excited, though. It says gents. I'm like, oh, gentlemen, this would be really nice. This is going to be a beautiful bathroom, you know? So I open up the door, and it takes me right back outside. Whizzing, as cars are whizzing by. At least they should give you like a top hat or something to wear. Then you really feel like a gentleman. That might actually be a little bit better. People in India generally, especially in the South, I find, are very nice. Okay? I'm not just saying that from medicine. I feel like that's true. People are very nice. They don't stare at you though. There's a lot of staring over there. It's almost like. Right? It's so odd. They just, if you look away. They don't want you to like think they're gay. Well, they're gay, that's a whole different issue, but they want you to be that big race. They're nice. The way they talk to you is different. Like here people will see me and even actually at the social hour. Oh, I saw your YouTube videos. That's a big thing, though. Oh, I saw your YouTube videos. In India, they say, oh, I saw your YouTubes. I love your YouTubes. I love your YouTubes. Yeah, I love your YouTubes. I love your YouTubes. It's not very personal. Like, you see my tubes. I don't have any tubes. I'm a man, okay? I don't have any spoken to like that. I'm very aware of that from pretty much, okay? So, now, I've been doing that, of course, for a couple of years. Because, you know, obviously, right, when you're an Indian and you have to go to college, like, all the other bubbles are just grayed out, you know? It's just like, you at least have to start pre-med. And I was pre-med a couple of years, now I'm post-med. I just skipped the med part, okay? That's where the work is. I do that. this job in particular, being a comedian, it's strange. Because people can see you do the job as you do it. That's weird as a job, right? Because I only get one shot, one opportunity. I'm like Eminem. I only get one shot, one opportunity to get up there and do it. Like, I can't like have him play all over. Like, this is the show. This is, we're here. This is it. You can see me do the job as I do it. That's strange. All my other friends, whatever their jobs are, I just have to assume they're good at their jobs. They tell me, like, oh, I'm this great lawyer. I'm like, you are. Nobody gets to see you do it. You know what I mean? Like, I don't. Do we have any doctors here, for example?
Yes.
Do you have any doctors? Okay, I'm in the convention. Don't tell me how many doctors. Let me find one here. Let me. Who's a brave doctor here? Come on, cut people open for a living. I can cut you open here. Like, what's that? Okay, so can you ask me, please? They'll beat you up. Dude, we're Hindus. We're peaceful. No great doctors. Want me to? Oh, right here. Is it, can you take your eyes just slightly, please? Okay. Oh, and you moved the spotlight. Very nice. That's very, very good. It's, you realize it's a wave and a particle. I've been reading a lot about physics lately. Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you for being a brave, positive man, by the way, for volunteering for what I volunteered for. So, sir, what kind of doctor? And anesthesiologist. Okay, so this is a great idea. Like, you're so insecure to knock people out. Like, no one will see you in your job. That's so perfect. I'm so excited. You owe that because you're the exact opposite of my job. Unless I'm really bad, I put people to sleep in the next 45 minutes, which could happen. Let's be honest, it could happen. Then that would be a very cheap form of anesthesiology. People just laugh until they fall asleep. Another kind of laughing gas, so that'd be good. I'm still not sure what doctors do. I'm still confused because, like, I feel like, do we have nurses here? Yes, we have a lot of nurses. Okay, we have those jobs from the Filipinos. Okay, cool. Oh, yeah, Carol, obviously we have nurses. Of course we have nurses. Anyone, any great nurses here? Oh, we had a doctor, Matthew, with a nurse. Okay, you're a nurse? All right. Nurse? Why are you registered? I don't understand this registry. Only people registered in society are nurses and, well, sex offenders, but that's a whole different thing. I'm going to get a registry. You guys are awesome, by the way. Okay, you guys are way better than normal. You guys are way open minded. That's good. Okay, so nurse. No, I feel like nurses do like 90% of the doctors. The job is done, and the doctor comes in to the room, right? After I'm in the waiting room, I'm in the room sitting on that, like, deli meat paper or whatever that is. I'm not sure what that is. It's the same level of quality of that. And then the doctor comes in. It's my moment. I've been waiting to ask you a lot of questions and all that stuff. And you're, like, there for, like, 2 minutes. And you keep leaving the room. I've never been to a doctor's appointment where they don't keep leaving the room. Like, I don't know. What are they doing? Are you, like, looking up stuff on WebMD? Like, what's happening there? Are you, like, I don't know. I'm just not sure why they keep leaving. And then they do all that. They prescribe medicine, right? They prescribe, and then a pharmacist gives me that. So you don't even do that part. The part that, like, helps me, yeah, they don't even do that. And then when you have to do surgery, to do surgery, they knock us out. We can't even see them do that. So it's the complete opposite of this job. I should have been a doctor because my parents wanted me to be a doctor for the longest time. And I'm a lot older than, well, I don't know how old you think I am, but I'm older than you think I am, probably. And so in 1994-95, Clinton's got involved with the medical profession, right? And so then doctors were not making as much money before. So then my parents were like, well, beta, maybe you should go into computers. And I'm like, well, I'm not South Indian, but I can try, you know, I can. Be a good Indian, you know, like the like program, pun intended. And so it's that. So I'm like, okay, I'll go into computers, but then the .com bust happened in 2000, and then the computer people weren't making as much money as they were before. You feel me on this, right? Feel me? That's pretty good. of me. Okay. So, and then they're like, I thought you should go to finance. And then 2008, so now suddenly they're like, okay, being a comedian doesn't look so risky anymore. So they're like, be a comedian, it's fine. Not a problem, it's fine, I'm working, it's good. Because I was tired of being compared to my friends. That was a big thing, right? It's like a lot of my friends, Indian friends, they became, or a lot of your friends become doctors. They become doctors, they're like beta, can you be more like God? He's, you know, he's a physiologist, like God, you know? He's like a lok, MD, PhD, MD, PhD, you know, so many letters, you know, there's so, I think they're spelling me, there's like brilliant letters, okay? They just want more and more letters. And so they're like, you know, be like that. And then I went into comedy, I was like, well, there's no Indians in comedy. Now my parents are like, why can't you not be more like a Aziz Ansari? So I can't save it. But the good thing about Canada is it only gets so bad. It only, like, even if it's not good, like, it's only so bad. Versus sketch comedy, which is tremendous. Okay, let me explain something to you. So sketch comedy is where you have like 5 or 6 people on the stage and they all try to be as funny as one guy. It never works, okay? Because I went to this show in LA, and this happens a lot. I live in Los Angeles now. I've been living in LA for almost 10 years. And anyone here from California? Quiet Californians, you guys are meditating or something like that, okay? You're very zen, okay? Well, you're definitely in California, very quiet, very quiet. So, in LA, it's weird because everybody else wants you to come to the show. It's very self-promotional. People are like, oh, you know, listen to my podcast, subscribe to my newsletter, come to my show. That's just me, all right? So, then they'll come up, like, come see me at the Laugh Factory, and they will come. And then they're like, oh, you should come see my brother at the room. And I'm like, oh, I don't want to do that. I don't want to, that sounds awful. I have no interest in doing that. They're like, no, but we need to see you at the Laugh Factory. I'm like, that's right. Our relationship right now is in equilibrium. Okay? You came to the show, you laughed, you left. We're in balance. We don't need to create this infinite feedback loop of factories and rainbows. Okay? It doesn't need to happen. So my friend is doing a sketch comedy show. And she's like, you got to come to the center for leukemia and lymphoma. Well, it's against leukemia and lymphoma. Like, you know what I mean? If it were for leukemia and lymphoma, that would be a total benefit because that's not, that would be really a terrible thing. So it was against leukemia and lymphoma, but the show was awful. Like, it was just not good at all. We're watching it never. We had to pay attention to get into the show. We're getting angrier and angrier. It's not good. And then there was an intermission. And I figured what they should have done if they wanted to raise a lot of money is they should have let everybody in the show for free and then shown us half of the show. Locked the doors, and then asked us how much money we pay to leave right now, and not lost the rest of the show. They would have raised enough money to cure cancer, I'm telling you. They would have done it. It would have been solved. There would have been no problem at all. So, do we have any actors here? I think, right? Probably, do we have anyone in entertainment? Any actors? Any aspiring actors? Yeah. Where else? I heard somebody say yes. Now the spotlight's going to come find you. It's okay, I'm not going to pick on you too much. No? Okay, your actor disappeared. Okay, that's fine. Maybe you can be a magician. That was better move. So, but actors, in LA, there's a ton of actors in the shows all the time. It happens all the time. And you always have to ask me, you know, what restaurants you work at. And that's what happened. If you've been to California, you've been like a restaurant, a lot of the waiters are actors. And they're working on like character or an actor. Or something like that. It's crazy. Like, you know, why don't you act like a waiter and bring us our food? Because that goal is open right now. You can book that right now. It can happen, you know? But I think what they need to do, they need to combine the role of actor, of like casting director and Trader Joe's sampler. Okay? They're the same job, really. All right? All of us do this. If you go to Trader Joe's or Costco, how many of the Indians here go to Costco? I'm sure a lot go to Costco, right? Dude, Costco is like home for Indians. Honestly, we love to go to Costco, especially like on a Saturday or something. Right now here is closed down because we're here, okay? Seriously, we go to Costco. Only thing I don't like about Costco is they check your receipt on the way out. I hate that. So make sure you haven't stolen anything, which is so annoying because like the portions at Costco were so big. What are you going to steal out of Costco, right? Who's like a pound of dog on your job? Steal anything at Costco? It's crazy. But the great thing your lunch. You know what I mean? You know what I'm talking about. Love to go to Costco and eat like 8 or 9 of the thing, and you're full, right? And you're full lunch. man. It's just the way it is. That's the best acting you can do. I'm telling you, if you want to be an actor, if you want to see if you're going to be good at that profession, all you have to do is see how well you are at juking that person out, pretending you're going to buy it. Because that's exactly what you can do. We only do that. We eat like 8 of those things, and we have to act like we're going to buy it. We're like, I'm gluten free. I can't. And you're like, right. You can juke that guy out. I feel like you'll book the role. You'll be good at it. I'm telling you, it's safe. So, performing, luckily, at least 3 times in the last 9 months. I don't know if anybody even says luckily with that, but I'm at the Middle East. And performing there, and it's great. People are really nice, really welcoming, and whatever else. I went to Kuwait, and they love Americans in Kuwait. They love Americans, because they're still a Kuwait. You know what I mean? Otherwise, they'd be Iraqis. So that's what I studied today. Happy birthday, America, by the way. Social experiment that was ever invented on the planet. So it's great that we're still here after 200 plus years. Pretty awesome. And so, but no, the Kuwaitis love us. And so we land at the Kuwaiti airport. We don't even need a visa. They just sign it to you and go on in. And the comedians there, they wanted to show us Kuwait. They were so excited. They loved their country. They wanted to show us Kuwait. They showed us the towers. And they took us to a mall. Not a guy named a mall. Shopping mall. Got him. Named a mall, but actually a shopping mall. Okay, so I wanted to clarify that. So, they took us to a mall, but and it's the largest mall in the Middle East, in Kuwait City. But they were so proud of it. I don't think they understood that they were not going to impress an American with their mall. We invented shopping malls. It doesn't matter how big it is, you're not going to impress us, right? So here, those same comedians are coming over here, and I'm going to take them to Death Valley. Because I feel like it's the only equivalent. Like, they're going to fly 15 hours, they're going to be in Los Angeles. Like, look, we have heat, we have sand. Welcome to America. Have a great time. Knock yourselves out. Now, in a lot of the Indians, I actually think are Indians, or really Persian. We have a lot of Persians in LA. And it's funny because they love to call themselves Persian, and I don't think they've looked at a map after 1935. Like, there is no Persia anymore. You know what I mean? They can call themselves Iranians at this point. You know, you don't meet some guy from Iraq who says he's Mesopotamian. You know what I mean? Like, it's done. It's over. You can evolve. Time. You don't meet some Mexican guy like, I'm Aztec, is it? No, you're not Aztec, all right? Or Mayan or Indian. It's done. It's fine. We can move on beyond that. But I don't know how we feel about immigration here in Texas. It's an issue. Like, actually, it's kind of gone away, but in Texas, California, Arizona, it's a big deal. But I feel like Americans tease Mexico because we have a state called New Mexico on the border. Of course they're going to come over here. They go to Boston if there's a place called New India. Like, you can't put something right on the border. That's totally crazy. Now, I was born in Ohio. My dad was born in El Pakistan. We're Punjabi. So he was born in, this is not the Punjabi convention, I know, because there's no alcohol. So I'm very aware that there's not a Punjabi convention. Now, Punjabi, as far as I know, are the soldiers of India. We're the soldiers, right? Unless you're like 5, 6, and 100 pounds. Okay. Then you become Indian. The country from anybody, it's not gonna happen at all. So, and by the way, I just got engaged to be married. Thank you very much. Actually, I'm marrying a Gujarati girl who lives in Austin. I'm just visiting her, and she's we're gonna be a Punjabi and Gujarati family. She works at Procter & Gamble, P&G, so it kind of actually works out really well. We're gonna be a P&G family, which goes along really well, which is pretty great. Actually, at Procter & Gamble for about 6 years before I resigned, before I quit, you know what I mean? Like, I'm important enough to resign, you know what I mean? A vice president or a general manager, those people resign. At my level, you just quit. Like, just come to court, like, get shot. You're not assassinated, I'm just dead. Like, really, like, I'm like an important guy, like, but it doesn't really matter. So I worked there for years, and my manager was still is, just 7 minutes. That'd be so weird. Now, what happened? I promoted. Screw God, that's hilarious. I don't care. That's funny. Whatever. The fact that people in this day and age are still racist, that's so gay. I'm trying to fuck with this just for the kids. You know, I gotta make a decision at some point. I gotta figure this out. So, but no, it's true. I actually, okay, I'm gonna say say that, actually. Nothing against gay men at all. They're very loyal. They always have your back. And, okay. What about Donald Trump? I don't think he's gay. The gay community was there's no way, no sign, he's too gummy, you know what I mean? I don't think Donald Trump, you think this is a chance? You think, yeah, I don't know, you guys think so? Man, he's gay, he needs to support them. Yeah. He is a gay, but not doesn't. Yeah, I think that would go, he should say, that would go over really well before he would have been. Gays don't shop at Macy's anyway, really. It's too low. Indians shop at Macy's. Indians love Macy's. Gay people, they're like the Nordstrom and stuff. Like, they're too top shelf, man. Especially in Dallas, man. No, Dallas is a big... Wait, I can say that. I can make fun of gay people because I'm homophobic. No. Because, actually, my brother's gay. That's actually true. He was not even Donald Trump, by the way. He's always been the gay world, right? So, and so being I want to know that. So when did you know you're gay? Like, he told us. I don't like I'm gonna answer that. I didn't know. Like, I grew up in Ohio in the 1980s. There was no such thing as gay. Like, you couldn't throw a football. That was like you could just tell the kids who were gay because of that. It was really crazy. Like, he told us a few years ago he came out of the closet. Well, we're Indian, so he came out covered. And he sat down with my parents. Remember, he sat down with and he said, the reason I haven't brought a girl home for so many years is I'm gay. And the room got very tense and very awkward, kind of like it did just now. But it wasn't as hard as the conversation I had with my parents when I said the reason I haven't brought a girl home for so many years is I'm a loser. So, my parents, they accepted it for a while and I came out of the loser closet, so that was good. But my brother, it's interesting because I have two brothers. I've met some of you at the meet and greet. I was telling you, some of you, this. So I have two brothers. They're fraternal twins. So can't really do a control test thing. They're fraternal. So I know we can do a test. Go to no, they're fraternal. That doesn't work. So they're not identical. They're fraternal twins. And they both live in New York City. Rotation's gay. The cost is straight. And as kids, we all got along really well. And Rakesh, you know, and the cost and I, we had our toys. We wanted to include Rakesh, you know, because I have Transformers. And the cost has GI. And Rakesh had his Barbie dolls. And it was just weird because it was hard to construct a battle scene with these three types of toys. You know, you're trying to be inclusive, but how do you do it? It was like Optimus Prime saving Barbie from like domestic violence pen or something, you know? Like, it got very adult very quickly. There's no way to keep it like age 8 under. It was just like, it got very serious, you know what I mean? Like, I don't think Easy Bake Oven. That's like My Little Pony. That was like good. That worked out for us or whatever. But I don't know. I just, with the new Supreme Court ruling, which I think is great, I'm all for it. I don't know where you guys are. Yeah, I think it's about time. And, it's funny because I remember, I feel like we're born accepting. I feel like we're born as accepting people, and then later we become unaccepting because people load us up with that stuff. But I remember being 9 years old. And being at the lunch table, and I'm sitting with my friends, and I was eating pizza. And I remember saying to my friend, I was like, oh my gosh, I love pizza. And my friend, John, he said this to me, because of course we're in third grade, what did everyone say when he said that? I was like, oh, I love pizza. And John goes, why don't you marry it? Right? That was the thing he said. I said in 1985. I feel like in 2015, we could two men and two women could marry each other. If we were ready to marry pizza, 1985, you know what I mean? I got totally fine if we're I would still marry pizza, honestly. I really would. I love my fiance, but pizza kind of accomplishes most of what I'm looking for, really. Really, honestly, for the single people out there, I don't know if you feel me on this. Because pizza, I was looking for someone hot. Pizza's hot. What's up? She's not here right now. She's with Donald Trump. He's got some more money. That's good. In the morning, so respect yourself. That works out pretty well. Pizza can be vegetarian. I can take her to temple. That's pretty good. Pizza's from Italy, has immigrant parents. My parents would be really happy with that. Pizza can feed a family of four. Let's see. Pizza's been with me through thick and thin. That's good. Pizza's cheesy, like my jokes. So that kind of works out. Yeah. I've noticed by this point, not all my jokes have punchlines. Okay, so like every joke is supposed to have a setup and a punchline, but not all my jokes have punchlines. But that's okay, right? Because you're such a good audience, you don't need the whole joke. You know what I mean? You can just do part of it. Because I feel like there's actually a comedy club in Atlanta called The Punchline. And I played there, I actually do very well at Punchline. I feel like I could really crush a club called The Setup. You know what I mean? If all I had to do was set up a joke and walk away, I would own that room. That would totally be my face. I would do great in there. You guys ever do a 3D movie? Been to a 3D movie. Been like Gravity or one of those movies. You know, they give you the red and blue glasses as they get in the film. You ever do this thing in the middle of the movie where you take the glasses off your face just to see what the film looks like without your glasses on? Yeah, it's crazy. You ever drive along your car and, you look at the odometer, and you notice it's like 9,992, 93, 94, 95. You get all excited. You're like, I'm going to be in the car for another 5-6 miles. I'm going to see it turn 10,000. On the trip, it's going to happen. And maybe you go drive through, you check your phone, you look down, it's like 10,004, and you're like, oh. Yeah. This is so stupid. Okay. Turn off a ceiling fan in your house, but it's not labeled, so you don't know if you're meant to go faster or turning it off. And you're kind of like, yeah, no, nobody does that. Okay, just 15 more. No, I'm kidding. Just one more. Never take a girl out to a restaurant, and you have to open the door for her, right? You open that door. Help me out on this. You still do this for your wife? You do? Does he do it? Oh, wow. Gets a yes. Okay, that's say whatever you want, but that's not always true. So you do this, like you open that first door, right? And then in that little room, and I know that door is for like ventilation purposes, but now she's in front of you. She gets to open that next door, the door that counts, the door that everybody sees, the door that makes you a dick because you never get the door for a lady. That's really annoying. I hate that. So, what's hard about that joke is it's real jokes after that. You know what I mean? It's hard to like tell a whole joke now. Sir, what do you do for a living? What do you do? Yeah. Okay, cool. How many single people do we have here tonight? Okay. And how many married people do we have? Okay, I know there's way more married people than single people. They're so tired they can't even clap. You want all of this, you need to be more like excited. You need to be salespeople for this thing, otherwise it's just not gonna work. Okay, so that's not good. I got engaged in December, and so I met my fiance online. Okay, so I met her on OkCupid, which have you heard of OkCupid? Is that a big thing here? Okay, so okay, the kids don't know I have. Okay, that's probably. Since you're what, 10? That's probably good. How old are you? 11. I'm mad. She's like, how did you get it so wrong? Like, okay. Alright, so in dark, I can tell. That's probably, she's probably good. I can tell how old the kid is. So anyway. But so the OkCupid is this site, a dating site, okay? And so we were on shady.com, of course, as well. Shady.com really is how you pronounce that. So, on that shabby.com profile. It's funny, they have you fill out things that the dating sites don't have you fill out, dating sites. And shabby.com is not a dating site for the wedding record. It's a matrimonial site. There's no dating, okay? There's no dating. So you just merge sites. okay? There's no such thing. We don't like to acknowledge that. So, started dating sites. So, Zan Shadi, Azani, Harmony, on OKCupid, and all these things. And on Shady.com is very interesting, but OKCupid is actually where we met. And she lives in Austin, and I've been in LA the whole time. We've been long distance the entire time. And we're going to get married in exactly a month. We're getting married in 4 weeks. And thank you. And yeah, we're going to get married in 4 weeks. And since we're doing it in Texas, it's going to be a Cowboys and Indians theme. And I'm not even making that up. That is totally true. We're totally doing that. And she's a pharmacist, and I'm a comedian. So our other theme is laughter is the best medicine, which kind of like basically wrote itself, which I thought was kind of good. So now, how long have you two been? He left just now. I don't know where Ushwin just went. 1 year. So where, how did you guys meet? At KHA? Dude, this is like, you guys are the ultimate billboard for marriage. At KHA? Okay, I'm sorry. 8 years ago, not married a year ago. So maybe it's not that good of a billboard. Okay, like you'll wait 7 years. You're like, okay, we're gonna wait time on the fire. We'll wait 7 years to get married. We'll wait on this. Okay, that's great. Okay, cool. Awesome. So, and then what did you guys become? Friends first, or what? How did you guys?
Yes.
Yes. You remember the days of being friended. Friended, that's not a word. Friend zoned. I went to US public school too, so. Alright, cool. Friend zoned. Alright. And then how did you finally break through? Because, I mean, she's clearly out of your league, so how did you. Really? You give a lot of hope to the audience, like, well, not her, then this is really good. Move, man. So you're in Chicago, and where were you? Oh, New York. So how did you? It's long distance. How did you make the move, man? Like, so you met 8 years ago, KHNA. Okay. You got her MySpace information 8 years ago. I don't even remember what was the topic 8 years ago.
I think it's
still phone. Okay, so you got her number. Where did it? Did you have like a move?
Actually, she called me first.
Oh! Injure you, but like, toss it at you. Threw the phone at me is like very like Chris Brown. You gotta be careful. That's yeah. Well, he's brown, but I mean it's a different kind of brown. So. But okay, so and then your digits in. Okay, that was my move. That's good. I would always go like, hand my phone to a girl. I wouldn't throw one at her, but I'd hand my phone to her. Like, oh, let me get your info. And if she gave me her email, she wanted to be friend. She gave me her number. She wanted to, we gotta keep it clean. She wanted to, you know, GDFR, you know, so. And so then how did it go after that? You called him and then you guys were friends, and, but what was the moment where you actually, like, penetrated the membrane? Like, how did you get it? Metaphorically, keep it clean. How did friend zone into the fire. It's just kind of, people always say that. Magical. Kismet. Kismet. It was meant to be. Alright. And now you've got this person in the middle of you. Who is this guy? It's so random. Like, you guys love, there's like this, like, fellow, like, midget sitting between you. Honestly, like, I can say that because that's what I say. So I totally get it. That's hilarious. You silly. Your hair, man. It's like, I do the joke, and your hairy ankles come up. Like, okay, I get it. All right, that's like, but, so seriously, I just have these two caterpillars, like, keep above my eyes. That's like the only thing I have. So, who are you? Is a friend? What is this? Referee? Or, like, who is this? Like, do you like a show? Nobody's like putting you in between, so something, no business or anything. You're what? You keep up. I like that. Okay, that's good. That's your role. Okay, cool. Did anyone else make a KHNA event? Do we have any other couples from this? They're shy, I know. No one else? You're the only? Do you guys know you're the only ones? Where are those other people? Are they here? Do you want to come out of them? Polite. One of the 18 guys I met. on this lot of pilates, like a pile of pilates. Yeah, pilai. Like my fiance, she prescribes other pills, they're not pills. But very close, very similar. So where do they go? They disappear or where do they go? We can't help them. They're hiding. They're shouting left and then they went to the back. They're like, nice, good. What's going to happen on today, Independence Day? I lose my independence. Do I know what I'm getting into? I've been there before. We probably should, but yeah. I think so. But how long have you been there? 26 days. 26 years. You're still paying for it. I love it. Spoke up gets you a good rally. I love that. Okay, that's awesome. And I've earned your careless status. Okay, which one? Existential. She's hidden. She's gonna hide. I don't know. Over here. She's somewhere. She's gonna beat me up. I like that. That's awesome. Where, but okay, she doesn't want to pull me right now. Okay, sure. She lives here. Okay. Is she there? She can keep an eye on you. That's good. It's getting to know where to sit. We sit in the back, where no one can hear us laughing at those jokes, or like sit in front. Everybody is worried about how come you knew that joke? What did that mean? They're like explaining what did that mean to them. That's scary. But you're good boys. And where do they live? Chicago. What do they do?
One of them is a sophomore.
A sophomore? Oh. So he broke his leg in Chicago, and then he flew home to Texas. You paid for the surgery. Here in Texas. Indian parents will do anything to keep kids home. Honestly. Like, anything. Like, you won't pay for the surgery in Chicago, but you paid for it here.
He
didn't
wish to do anything to make their parents pay for it.
That's true. If kids do anything, come home. That's right. We need that food, we need that laundry. That's really important. Oh, we need you also, yeah, we'd like to come home. That's true. Now, that's true, because I remember, like, when I was for the Christmas holidays, as I was my friend John, the elementary school, we're still really good friends, and we're going out over Christmas, and my parents were like, you'll call us when you're at Paulus. Now, Indian parents always want you to call them, right? We didn't know the person, they just want to know where we were. Okay, so they called us. And I was like, well, I'll call you, like, when I'm out on campus. You know, I'm not for the same thing to his parents. Like, I'm not gonna call you. Like, you don't know where I am at 5 in the morning on campus. And his dad is like, oh, that's a good point. He's like, go out, you know. I try to say, my dad is like, okay, this mess up. It doesn't work the same way, honestly. The logic sort of breaks down. It doesn't really work out. So, has anyone been married more than 26 years? Oh, right here, sitting in the front row. 50 years? Yeah, you've been married 26 years, and your wife is like halfway back. 50 years, so your wife is like way in the back. In the lunch, I think. She likes to keep on you, I think. That's you. Where's your wife? This is works. This is very good. I like that. Okay. Right over here. Oh, closer. Okay, she's right here. I get this. I get the stuff. Cool. I love a chair next to him to an empty chair. But you'd rather sit next to an empty chair than have your wife sit here. That's nice. That's really sweet of you. What a kind man. That's awesome. That's... She doesn't want to.
Last night, I went to gym every day.
Kaminsky? Jimmy Kimmel. Kaminsky, okay. I don't know. Stage. You should put it on YouTube. Would have been YouTube. I'm telling you, you should have. That's crazy. Lines. My mom just doesn't believe in dinosaurs. This is crazy. I don't even know why I'm telling you. I don't even know. It's just crazy. Like, she doesn't believe, like, I'm going to go see Jurassic World. By the way, it's awesome. It's really good. Really good. Awesome. Remember in like 93 when the first one came out? I'm that old. Okay? So I just remember that. It's really good. And then Lost World, it broke all the records. But it wasn't very good. A lot of this new one is really awesome. But she doesn't believe in dinosaurs, which is really odd. Like, I'm like, why don't you believe in dinosaurs, Mom? And she goes, they're just too big. And the whole rationale. She's like, I'm like, no, but there's the fossils and like whole skeletons of them. She just thinks it's a big conspiracy. Like, it's a big conspiracy. I'm like, but boom, like, boom. And she's like, these museums, you know? And I'm like, but the museum, like, what's happening? What's the conspiracy? They're just making money, you know. And like, they're free. Museums are free. How they make it makes no sense whatsoever. Like, she's just, it's crazy that she doesn't believe in dinosaurs. It's so odd. And I told her, like, she saw me do that. I told her in Cincinnati, she was in the audience. And, then after the show, mom comes up to me and she's like, can you please stop telling everybody you don't believe in dinosaurs? Like, Mom, could you then please stop believing in dinosaurs? Like, I don't know what to say to that. That's totally insane. I just want to tell you that. That's so funny. Now, there's more people here than I expected. I didn't think it would be my fault, but like, I actually know. Anyone here got a dinner by yourself? Anyone ever gotten dinner by yourself? By yourself? Yeah? Business trip when you had an account and we're in need, so we want to spend it. Like, not that kind of thing. Like, no, like, actually, dinner in your hometown by yourself. Like a sit down, not a boat way, but like a sit down place. Okay. It's tough. I'm not secure enough to do that. I really admire people who do that. I think it's amazing. But I have gone to the movies by myself. It's awesome. If you've gone to movies by yourself, it's really actually funny. It sounds like a loser, but really, it is actually awesome. And so I told my friend this, and he was like really jealous. My friend looked at the ophthalmologist, and he was really jealous. He was like, well, I'm going to the movies by myself, you know? And so he goes to a theater about this large. He sits down, and nobody's in the theater. No one. So he really goes to the movies. No one's there. I'm upset. I'm like, he's gonna trump me. But then, I think the previews are on. Some guy, not making this up, came to the theater and sat right next to him. Why would you do that? If I went to the costume, the only car, and somebody parks right next to you, like, why are you doing that? Like, it makes no sense whatsoever. It's so dumb. You know, the sad thing about human trafficking is, that it happens, okay? Let me explain that. The point is that my fiance and I have long distance the whole time. She's in Austin, I'm in Los Angeles. So at the end of every trip, we always hug each other and we have a conversation with long distance couples too that you probably did too in New York or Chicago. They're like, oh, I just want to put you in a little box and take you with me. That happens. It's called trafficking, but they don't get the little speech. That's what's sad about it. That joke is for four people. That's fine. That's not all jokes and humor. Before I get out of here, I want to say that actually, this may be a little bit. We all have a number on a scale from 1 to 10. So when you're out there dating, you will learn what your number is, okay? You don't get to choose your number. Society like assigns it to you. And you learn it kind of painfully sometimes when you're out there. And I'm a 6, and I know that. And she's looking at me. She's laughing. She's like, dude, you're a 4. But the rule is, came up with a formula, okay? The rule is, you can only date and be happy with somebody who's upper one digit from you on scale, okay? So I'm a 6. I should only be able to date and marry a 6 or 7. But I'm not a parent. People are like, oh, how's that possible? What about your rule? Ladies, you are what you are. If you're a 9, you're a 9, you're beautiful. But you can't go up or down on the scale, okay? Now, fellas can go up on the scale if we're funny and we have money, okay? A little bit of a loophole for men in this show, but it's exciting, okay? So I'm a 6 for looks. And I'm most nights, so I become a 7. And I find the bank, so I become 8. And now I dated and I'm going to marry a 10. Okay? I know some of you are laughing. Some of you are like, wait a second, that's still 2 numbers apart. What you do is you meet a 10 and you bring her self-esteem down so she thinks she's a 9. We actually met on OkCupid like, and for our first date, I looked her up. That's what you have to do in 2015. Like, I Googled her up for that. We sat down for our first date at Whole Foods, and I thought it was a donut shop. And we sit down, and I told her, I'm like, I Googled you, I looked you up on LinkedIn and Facebook and all these places, you know, Twitter. I could find you anywhere. She goes, that's so creepy. I can't believe you just said that you stalked me online. I go, no, you're creepy. I can't find you. Until like a month. You know what I mean? How many of you remember the movie Back to the Future? Okay? Back to the Future was a movie that came out in the 80s, and 1985 was the present. 1955 was the past. And 2015 was the future. Okay? So in 2015, a lot of us were super disappointed. Right? Because there's no packs, no flying cars, none of that stuff, no time travel. But January looked exactly like December. Until June came around, and everything in 2015 was different, right? You have Rachel Dolezal, who's white, but she's black, but she's really white. And then you have Bruce Jenner, right? Like, there's no Bruce Jenner anymore. Like, it's gone. Like, it's gone for Teddy's ass to get out of bed. They can just leave the earth without disappearing. It's crazy. Like, Caitlyn Jenner is a man, but is a woman, and now, like, cops are good, but they're bad, but they're good, and then there was that dress that clearly was white and gold. If somebody wanted to call it black and blue, I don't want anything in it anymore, man. I don't know if you want those, Rachel, don't interview. It's so weird. She's telling her story. She's like, well, white, I identify as black. Well, I'm Indian, I identify as Californian. That doesn't mean anything, okay? But she's telling, like, how her parents were white, giving interviews, saying they had 4 kids. And then Rachel Dolezal marries a black guy as a mixed child. Suddenly, like, Game of Thrones is not that convincing anymore, right? Like, if I get the character in the family tree, it's more sense now. It's totally crazy. So, I met Herschel on OkCupid, not on Shabby.com. I did want to be very clear about that. But the quality on Shabby, it's gone up. It's good. Like, there's a lot. It's mostly brown women. It's mostly Indian women. But every now and then, you find a white girl on there. And it's weird. It's like, is she lost? Like, what happened? Like, what is she doing here? But it's kind of refreshing. It's like finding an onion in your face. Like, I don't mind if I do it. You guys are not fun. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.